Over here, I have a function database, connect database, MySQL injection, a random password, a function check login, also login, okay, to assign then the decision. Welcome to our class, the modern language programming. And today class is about object-oriented programming. We have the word that we call object-oriented programming, or a short name we call OOP. Before we go and continue about object-oriented programming, let's see something that we, if we have a legacy system or application, what we should do before. One thing that have been done before, this thing that we call a function. We have function, the main point of function is they try to grouping the same logic, okay? The same logic, the same the code that you are using, repeating using again and again, and then you should create some such as the function. As I mentioned here, the function which are the name of block of code that are designed to do one specific job, okay? Define in a function, you call the function responsible for it, okay? You don't need to type all code for the same task again and again. This is the main point of the function. If you see your code that you use it again and again, so you should create the first thing is about function, okay? That function one, function two, or whatever. For example, as the database function or login function or, and so on, okay? Why we have to do function? Because it's easy to write and read, test and fix, okay? This is the main point of a function. They try to grouping the same logic of code together, okay? You wanna use, you call it and use it again. You don't need to write the code from the beginning to the end again, okay? You call it and use it. This is the main point of the function, okay? When you have a function, there are also function for built-in function, okay? There are many function, built-in functions such as MySQL connection, converting from one type of data to another type, or converting from lowercase to uppercase, or from uppercase to lowercase. There are pre-built function or built-in function that defined by the PHP, okay? This is the way how we can calling a function, okay? We assign, we create some variable that used to store the value of that function, and then we follow by the function name. If they are that function, they consist of parameter, we have to specify the parameter, okay? Some example of functions such as if we want to count the length of the string, we can use a string length, okay? If we want to count, we calculate the sign, okay? So we can use sign. This is the built-in function, okay? And also unlink, this is a built-in function that provide by the programming language. As here, we are using PHP, okay? There are many built-in function in PHP. Whatever you're using, database connection, you're using session, there's all function, okay? Because the PHP itself is based on function, okay? If you want to create your own function, this is the pseudo code for creating a function, okay? You start by the keyword as function, okay? Function, and then followed by function name, and then followed by parameter. Parameter is option, okay? You can specify it or not, it depends on you, okay? But it's option. And then open bracket, close bracket, and then start by the statement list, okay? Something that you want to do. This function can do what kind of task. This is called statement list. Let's see the example of function, okay? This is a function of, this is the function of we want to concatenate, okay? Concatenate or bring two sentence or two string come together, okay? We call concatenation, okay? We define function name string strcat, okay? This is the function that we call, okay? And then we apply two argument here, okay? Two argument, that is left and right, okay? And then inside the function, we have statement that call combine string, okay? Equal to left and right, okay? and then we return that value, that is the combined string and the combined string. Okay, this is simple function that we, if we want to define any function in our application. Okay, from that, the first figure, let's see the second figure, we can use, how can we use that function. Okay, first we have to specify the first and second, or the argument that we want to send into the function. There is first equal to this is a, and then second is a complete sentence. So we echo, and we want to display our function, and then we call the function and followed by the argument that we want to send to the function to do the concatenation. Okay, that is the first and second, and then it should return the complete sentence. It will be the result as this is a complete sentence. Okay, we can next function declaration, or we can declare a function within a function. For example, here we say a function outer and function inner. Okay, that function outer that accept one argument, that is argument A, and then inner accept one argument B. Okay, and then we use the outer, and then we use the inner, and then the sentence will be well. Okay, hello there, reader. Something like this. This is the main point of this thing is we can build a function within a function. Okay, it's something that more complicated, more complex statement. You can use such this. Okay, the grouping of function. Okay, function variable scope. We have two types of variable scope in function. There is global and static. Okay. A global mean it can be accessed for outside. Okay, can be one you declare, you can use anywhere. Static mean that we count the things. Okay, it will not be leave the result out. Okay, this is called static. Let's see. If you want a variable in a global scope to be accessible from within a function, you can use the global keyword. Okay, this is the pseudocode that you can use to define the global variable. Okay, we use global and followed by variable. It can be one variable in one sentence, or can be two variable. It can be also. Okay, let's see the example of here. Okay, we have one, and we have two example here. The first is we say without any global apply, variable global apply in the first figure, and the second we apply for the global variable. If you see the first figure, you can say that because we in function foo, we use and then we try to access variable A from outside. So if we say this one, and when we call foo function, it will return something. Okay, if we return something, that is they just only accept only A. Okay, mean the result will be what? Will be 5, right? 3 + 2 = 5. But in function foo, okay, in global. So sorry, the first figure is they will they will echo just only variable 3. Okay, mean they will display just only 3 because the A is outside of the global. But for the second figure, it defines the global A. Okay, the global A, the global variable A. So they mean that we can access from outside. Okay, A from outside the equal to 2 can be accessed to inside. Mean A 3 + 2 = 5. Okay, this is the main point of global. When you define the global, it can be used any. If you do not define the global, it just is on that local area. Okay. Static variables. A static variable retains its value between all calls to the function, and it initializes during a script execution only the first time the function is called. Okay. When you add one. To static, it will retain mean, or it will keep the result 1. If you add more, it become 2, it will retain or keep the result to 2. Okay, it different with dynamic. When you add 1, it will remember. When you re-execute the code, it will lose that number. Okay, it will restart from 0 again. This is different between static and dynamic. Okay, Static means that it will keep the result, okay? Wherever you run the loop again and again, it will keep 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? For example, if dynamic, they will start from 1, and then when you restart again, it will become 1 again. It says dynamic and static. Let's see this one. If we define a static variable, for example, here we have a function counter, okay? And then we define a count variable count as static, and then start from 0, and then we return count variable plus plus, and then we looping by using for, okay, i equal to 1 and i less than or equal to 5, and then i plus plus and print counter. Mean that if we have static, we should get the result is 0 to 4, okay? Otherwise, it will print the 0 only, not 0 to 4. Okay, without the static variable. Okay, you want to keep the variable during the execution time, so better to use static. Okay, function parameters. Okay, we have the parameter is option in function. Okay, we can pass the parameter by value, we can pass parameter by referent, and then we can set the parameter by default. Okay, direct set the value of the parameters. Let's say one by one. Okay, passing parameter by value, the argument is only valid expression. That expression is evaluated, and the resulting value is assigned to the appropriate variable in the function. The mean that you set by values mean that you set a variable and then followed by the value, any kind of value, okay, number, string, whatever. This is the fast by value. Most of parameter that we are setting is using this thing. Okay, use through this way. Okay, passing parameter by value. As all that you see the example from the previous on this slide, there is a pass parameter by value. Okay, passing parameter by referent. Passing parameter by referent allow you to override the normal scoping rules and give a function direct access to a variable. A function will be passed by referent by preceding the variable name in the parameter list with a ampersand symbol. Okay, this one you do not assign any variable to the parameter directly, but you assign via referent. You reference to some variable. Okay, let's see the example. This one is a comparison between the same function, that is doubler. Okay, the first figure is about that we assign by referent. The second is we assign by value. Okay, this one. You see this one. We have a function doubler. Okay, then ampersand and then dollar sign equal to value. There is a variable that we the argument that we use. Okay, and then we try to do some statement. Okay, value equal to value less than and then 1. Okay, mean that we want to double. Okay, we want to double. For example, we send 3, and then we say that it should be double one time equal to 6. Okay, this is called double by referent. If we the second example in this figure, see double without any using any referent, but we want to double, so it will be the 13 will be double. Okay, will be double. The result will be 263. Okay, 263, not by 13 by 13, but it should be double by default. But the first example is they are try to double by using referent. Is not direct access to the value, but by referent. As you see, you can see an a equal to 3, and then double equal to dollar sign a, and then you assign by using ampersand. Okay, this is different by using parameter by referent and parameter by using the value. Okay, we have another parameter, that is a default parameter. Assign the parameter value in a function declaration. The value assigned to a parameter as a default value cannot be complex expression, only scalar value, mean the simple expression. Okay, simple expression. Let's see one by one. The default parameter mean if the parameter do not set this thing will work automatically, okay? Otherwise, it will be override by the given parameter. Okay, this is the meaning of default parameter. We can say the default parameter, for example, here we have function get preference or setting which preference equal to all. Okay, if you set something this one, mean that it will work the parameter which preference the value will be all. Okay, if you do not when you call and you do not specify any parameter, this one will be the default parameter or default value for this function. Okay, can you see this one? There is in the folder of PHP function. Okay, I already uploaded it to you. Okay, and also I list the function that I use for this presentation. Okay, and then I upload also plus by the my favorite function. Okay, my favorite function. I uploaded 3 of many that I ever use it. Okay, for example, this one I have a function utility. Okay, I have function utility that I return for many purposes. Okay, I try to grouping the thing that I try to use again and again. Okay, that we call logic. Okay, for example, here I have a function database, connect database. This is an old function. You may not use it. You should not use this one because it's the connection of MySQL connect is already expired. Okay, it's not suitable for use for on PHP 7 and PHP 8. Okay, this is just example. Okay, I have another function such as MySQL injection. Okay, try to protect the code from the SQL injection. I try to write this one also. We can define the function, because this function we have to use when we have a connection to the database, and then we want to make our connection and our SQL query more secure. So we have to write some kind of injection. Okay, I have also a function for a random password. Okay, a random password that we want to use. For example, you want to add some kind of password, and then we don't know what kind of pattern or what kind of password they choose suitable for us, so we can use this one. Okay, we can call this function. Okay, we can call this function, and then it will random, and then it will return the password based on our pattern, that is this one A to Z and 0 to 9. Okay, you can add another what we call format of the random password. It is this thing. Okay, it will random from 0 to 7. Okay, mean that it will contain 8 character. Okay, 8 alphabet of the 8 alphabet and all number in this function. Okay, if you want to send an email, this one also we can use it. Okay, to send an email. Okay, we have the sender, receiver, and so on, and then the content, and then we encapting, we have encoder, something like this. We translate to make it more standard in UTF-8 and so on, this one. Okay, but in the modern way, you should not use something like this. Okay, you can use the component that written by someone over there. Okay, or mailer, you can say. Okay, we can use the mailer to send the code rather than you write the code like this. Okay, if it's still working, okay, it's still working, but it's not the what we call the best or the good way to do. Okay, I have a function check login. For example, if you have many, because every pages you have to do a session, right, to store the username and user ID to tracking who are using the function. Okay, you can use this one to check and then assign them the session and then redirect to which page. Okay, I used to use this one, a session to check login. Okay, and then also login. Okay, to assign then the session that who is already assigned it can go to that that page, or why they have no authorization, or they have no permission to access that page. Okay. I have another file. Okay, session. Okay, this is I use session also. I used to keep the decision that I will check that this person is have the authority or not to access the page, okay, of the our application. We can use this one. Otherwise, they will return some message error or something like this. This is a function that we always use it, and then we want to make it available. We don't want to write it again and again on every pages of our application. Okay, so we create such a function. I have error write something like delete all, for example. If you have many times to use delete, okay, in database, right? You have to add, update, and delete, right? If you have the something that you have function over there, you have a function add and edit and delete. This one is for delete, okay. You don't need to write any long sentence for every page. You call this one if you want to delete any field, any row of database. Okay, you can use this one to delete it. Okay, you can use this one, MySQL prep. Okay, I used to escape the string. Okay, if there are capital letter, small letter, we should be escape it before we enter into the database. Otherwise, your application may be vulnerability or unsecure. Okay, this is the function, the sum of function that I ever use. Okay, in the application there are many over there. This is, but I can show to you this one. But in this way, I do not recommend you to write if you want to create any application, but still work. Okay, you should move to another thing, such as using a class or framework or library or component over there. Okay, because they done a group of people already done some kind of best practice over there, so better to use something like that. Okay, object-oriented programming. Okay, this is one kind of approach that suitable for us if we want to move from function, okay, from function to object oriented. It will be nice approach. Okay, but if you write something about programming, about your project become more complex, the code is more longer, so we should organize our code into object oriented programming. The main point of the object oriented is we should talk. The first thing is about object oriented. Okay, object oriented. As we know that object oriented is everything will have to look at everything. Okay, as object. Okay, it will represent everything as an object. It related to our life also. Everything around us is object. We can see. Okay. In the object oriented approach, we have three things that working together. Okay, working together. Even we are talking about object oriented programming, but the approach of object oriented, they are combined of three things. Okay, the first is object oriented analysis, object oriented design, and object oriented programming. This is will be the three principle of object oriented. Okay, so you learn about object oriented programming. So they will apply the object-oriented design. Okay, the design is they show a big picture or display some kind of object-oriented analysis in terms of figure or annotation, such as class diagram, activity diagram, and sequence diagram. Okay, this is example of class diagram that represent the object. Okay, we have many object here. We have parents, we have object C, A, B, C. Okay, we have a parent A, B, we have parent C. This is the all is object. Okay, they are represent in terms of class diagram. Okay, in object oriented, we have many things to discuss. Okay, this is the thing that if we are discuss about object oriented, this one will be the main and the core concept and the principle and what we call the discipline about the object oriented. Okay, first is about core concept. You are beginner, you should look at this one. Object class of abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance and polymorphism. Okay, this is the core concept or basic concept of the object oriented. Okay, whatever object oriented analysis and design or object oriented programming. Okay, use case. Okay, use case as actor, user story, scenario and use case. This is the thing that we include on the object and object oriented analysis that we use to analyze and design, and then we use object-oriented programming to writing the code based on the use case. Okay, domain modeling. Okay, we have such as a class relationship, class responsibility, CRC card. We have conceptual model. This is about domain modeling. Okay, that used to draw the relationship or used to tell what this class have to do with another. Okay, the classes. This is the main point also of the object oriented. We have static, we have shared member, we have class diagram, we have object lifetime, we have converting class diagram to code, something like this from the model to code. We call converting class diagram to code. Okay, I already upload one of the model that convert to code. Okay, we call code generator by using star UML. I already upload it to the GitHub of mine. Okay, you can check it. Okay, inheritance and composition. This is the thing that we do in the object oriented. We can inherit. Okay, again, we can fold, we can borrow the parent's property and object. We can borrow the parent property and method. We call inherent. Okay, we can use interfaces. Okay, we specify name and then we can use interfaces as the global name will be one standard. Okay, aggregation, we have a composition, inheritance situation and so on. This is the way that the inheritance and composition doing. Okay, we have advanced concept of object oriented as UML tool, sequence diagram. We have object oriented design pattern. We have object oriented design principle. Okay, as we have many pattern that apply. If you look at any library, they apply a lot of pattern, especially design pattern. Okay, as a facade design pattern, and memento or design pattern as singleton, something like this, and repository design pattern and so on. Okay, we have the principle of object oriented design as solid. We have grasp, we have development principle and so on. This is the principle that we use to drive the object oriented design. Okay, this is the thing about object oriented. There are a lot of things to discuss about object oriented. Okay, the object oriented programming or OOP is one of the most effective approaches to writing a software. Okay, in object-oriented programming, you write classes that represent real-world things, okay, and situation. This is real-world thing mean represent in terms of classes or object, and then situation. And then you create an object. You create an object based on these classes. Okay, when you write a class, you define the general behavior or property that a whole category of object can have. Okay, behavior can be property, can be method or function. This one we call behavior. Okay, so in the short definition of object oriented programming is you represent the real world things and situation based on classes. Okay, the classes can be represented as a blueprint or the prototype of the object. Okay, and then the object is they will implement the classes. Okay, we call object. In a class, it will consist of the class name, class property, and then class function, okay, or class method. Object-oriented programming, if you look at any object-oriented programming, they will consist of this thing, okay, class, method, property, instance, constructor, and static method. This is the vocabulary that you have to be familiar when you are working with object-oriented programming. Okay, class. Okay, class. The class is will be the first thing that when we talk about object oriented, the class will be represent to us. Okay, in terms of object oriented programming, we use a class to represent a real world things and the situation. Okay, a class is a template for building objects. Okay, any class that used to represent the real things, okay, the real world thing, whatever thing that around us, we represent in terms of class. Okay, as you see here, we have the class dog. Okay, if we want to create an object, we can specify many type of dog. Okay, we can be a dog name, for example, they are share the same thing, they are property, they are method over there. The class name is dog. The properties, there are many. For example, here color, eye color, height, length, weight, and method, maybe sit, lay down, shake, and then come, something like this. This is a method, property, and the class name. And when we extend the class, and then we want to initiate any object, okay, so we can use the base class or the class, okay, to be an object, and then we can specify the object. Okay, for example, the dog can be named Bobby. Okay, the property can be yellow. For example, color is yellow, eye color is brown, and method maybe sit, lay down, and check, come, something like this. Okay, this is the main point of class and object. Okay, in PHP, we can create a class or declaring a class by using a class name, okay, by follow class and then follow by class name. Okay, class and follow by class name, and then we can have the extend, we have implement, we have interface, we have what we call property and method. Okay, the property will be dollar sign and property as you define the variable in PHP. The function or method will be named as function. Okay, the method and function is the same thing. Okay, but different name. Okay, we talk about method, right? We are talk about function. Okay, on the at the beginning of the class, and then that all thing of that knowledge can be applied to this class function. Okay, they are the same thing. Okay, you want to define function in class, we can specify function and then follow by function name. Okay, follow by argument, whatever argument is option. Okay, is option, and then follow by on class. Inside the class, you can specify any statement. Okay, statement 1, statement 2, or whatever, echo something, plus a plus 1 equal to something. This is they should be specified within function. Okay, let's see, we have a class. For example, we want to declare a class name as person. So this is the thing that it will be look like for class person. Okay, class person, public name. Okay, then we have a function, two function here, function get name, function set name. Okay, so the class person is a class name. Okay, and dollar sign name is a property. Okay, the get name and set name is the method or function of the class. Okay, and then if you see the in the function set name, we have one argument that is set a new name. Okay, a new name. Okay, if we try to draw the class diagram, we will see as illustrated in the right hand side. Okay, in right hand side, if we see the figure. Class, okay, person and name, and then set name and get name. Okay, this one. Object, okay. Object is if you want to initiate. Okay, we want to use the class. Okay, we want to use the class. For example, we want to use a class person. So we have to use an object to initiate, to create the thing from the class. Okay, an object is instance or occurrence of a class. Okay, a class can be one, object can be many. Okay, as I showed to you about dog. Okay, dog is a class. Bobby, funny, or whatever name of dog can be many as an object. Okay, In PHP, we can create an object like this, okay? We start by $ object, okay, any name, okay? It can be any name, variable, and then follow by new, okay? We use new and then class name, okay? For example, we want to create an object of class person, okay? We use object equal to new person, okay? If we have object equal to a person with a double quote, okay, it's not work. As I showed to you, that we come something red underline, okay, it show you that this is not work, okay. If your object equal to new person and then Zina 35, something, this is work because it will send two argument to there. But argument also should be available at class person, okay. Otherwise, it will not work also, okay. Class equal to a person, and then we use that as a reference to the class, okay? Object equal to new and then $ class. This is we can use also. Or is equal to object new to person, the same thing, okay? If you want to write the code a little bit more flexible, you can use that class equal to person and then object new $ class, okay? This is about how we can create an object from the class, okay? Method in class, we can say that the function, okay, the method and the function is the same thing but different name, okay. The function associated with an object are called its method, okay. A method is a function defined inside a class, okay. A method is a function defined inside a class. So don't be confused about method and function. They are the same thing but represent in different name, okay. You want the access method, okay, you can use object, okay, followed by a function name, okay, because they represent in term of PHP, they are represented in term of name of function, okay. We call method, but when we want to define, when we want to declare on object or PHP, we use function, okay. Method can be static, can be final, okay. Method can be public, private, and protected as term or access modifier, okay. Declaring method, okay, for example, here we have a class person, right? We have two methods, as I said to you. We have a get name, we have a set name. This is two methods that we declare on this classes, okay, on this class, okay. This is another example of a method. We have a method start table, we have end table, okay, two methods. It is a kind of static method, okay, static method. If you look at carefully about static, you can access the static method without, you no need to declare on any object first. You no need to initiate any object, you can direct access to the static method. For example, here we have HTML stuff and then followed by the start table, okay. Properties, okay, the data, okay, when we talk about property, it's about talking about data. The data associated with an object are called its property, okay. Property can be accessed by object and then followed by the symbol, okay, and then followed by the property name, okay. The property can be static, can be final, can be public, can be private, and protected, okay. This is the access modifier, and then there's the style of the properties, okay. Declaring properties, you look at here, we have the property name, we have property egg, we have property day, okay, that defined by $, okay. It's same as you define the any kind of variable, okay. But you look at here, the property should be scala, okay, should be scala, it should be something simple, okay, it should be something short, not something doing some calculating or something that mathematic inside the property, okay. As you say here, we say name for is okay, H0 is okay, but you say day 60 multiple by 60 multiple by house in a day, it doesn't work, okay. If we got some error for you, okay. It should be something simple, okay? One single Scala. Property can be accessed from access modifier, okay? We can declare the access modifier to the property. For example, here we say protected, okay? As row ID is equal to 0, public user is you can say that anyone can see me as public, and private and hidden, okay? It's hidden. Using just no one can access it except a person inside, okay? Protected is it can be used from outside, okay? Public also can be used from outside, okay? Access modifier, okay? We have three types of access modifier. First is public, the second is private, and the third is protected. Okay, access modifier can be applied to property and method. Okay, the access modifier, the short meaning of access modifier is visibility. And you want to visible to you want to make it available to show or not. Okay, to show just only inside, available inside class only, or outside only, or can be accessible from outside only, or something that is protected, public or private. The thing that is this thing we call access modifier. Okay. For example, if you want to make the property and method that available from outside, you have to set as public. If you want to make it private, I mean that it can be used only within the class or within a class or within a method. So you use a private. If you want to make it available from outside, okay, but inside cannot be accessed because protected. Okay. Example here, there are symbol also on the figure, a class name person. We have symbol plus, okay, a plus symbol. We have minus and char, right? A char will represent a protected. Minus is private. Plus mean public. Okay, this in terms of class diagram representation. Okay, it can be applied for property and method. As the meaning of the public, private, protected, as you can see here, the public is a method and property can be read and written from outside the class. Okay, the private is prevent any code outside the class from accessing the property and method. Okay, the protected is you can say that mean that the only code outside the class can access the property is code in the subclasses. Okay. So if you want to make public this one, it can be accessed from outside. Okay, okay. If you said the property and method to be private, so it prevent from any kind of code that from outside to access that property and class, property and method. Okay, the protected can be accessed from outside. Okay, can be accessed from outside. There are a way to choose visibility or choosing the access modifier. You can I illustrated on this figure. If you want to make this thing access from external, mean outside or not? Yes, you say yes, it's public. Okay, it's no deny to children. Okay, deny to the children mean that when someone wants some code, okay, some class extend the parent class or subclass, or sorry, the parent class or superclass. Yes or not? Yes, you said private. If no, you don't want to protect any. You don't want to do what we say. You don't want to make any visibility and visibility. So you can use protected. So it can be accessed to anywhere by using protected. Okay, this is the way how to choose. Okay, if you wanna make it available outside public. Okay, if you wanna deny to its children, mean that subclass, use private. Okay, if not, using protected. Okay, the default visibility or access modifier will be the public. Okay, constant. Okay, constant is one a constant is defined, its value cannot be changed. Okay, one the constant is defined. When you define the constant, the value cannot be changed. Okay, constant can be accessed directly through the class or within object method using self notation. Okay, we define by using const, const, and then if you wanna access that constant, you use self in terms of PHP. Declaring a constant, you can see here, class, we have class payment method. Okay, we have two constant here. We have a constant type credit card and then type of cash. Okay, And then when we want to access, we define the class name and then followed by semicolon, okay? colon, and then followed by the constant name, okay? Constant name, for example, type credit card here, okay? Constructor, okay? Constructor. The constructor method is a special function that call when we initiate an object, and we call this is the constructor, okay? Anything that you want to, when you call the class, and then you want a method run automatically when you call class, we have to use construct, okay? Because we use a constructor that define as construct in terms of PHP. For example, here we have a class person, function, followed by underscore, two underscore, and then construct name and age. When you call the person mean, when you call a person class, the function of construct will automatically run, okay? You don't need to call that function, okay? This is a constructor also, it defined as the magic method, okay? It will, according to this example, it will return you, okay, name and age. It will assign you name and age, okay? Destructor, okay? Destruct is the destructor is called when the object is destroyed and allow us to run any shutdown or clean up task this object need. Okay, if you want to destroy any object, okay, you can call destructor, okay, to destroy it. But as a PHP is dynamic type programming, so it will destroy by itself, okay. But if you want to specify some kind of a method or some kind of function or some kind of variable you want to destroy, you can call the destruct, okay? Example as this thing, okay? Okay, we want to destroy some kind of sentence, okay? You can use this one. You define, for example, you want to destroy some kind of things, okay? We define as class, for example, here we define as a class building, followed by function destroy and then echo. If destroy is this function work well, it will return this sentence. Okay, you can apply to any to a method, to a properties. Okay, you want to destroy or delete the memory in the computer block, so you can use this destruct. Okay, to destroy that block. Okay. Okay. One of the advantages of using object-oriented approach, okay, there is inheritance. The inheritance is the way that class related to each other, okay. We want to, when we declare a class already, so we want to use the method or the property of another class we call parent class or super class. We can implement this inheritance, okay. In PHP we use extend, okay. For example, I'm inherit from my parent, okay, to be me, something like this, okay. Example as we have a class person, right? So we want to create a new class that we call employee. So in class person, they already have the property such as name, address, age. So in class employee, we no need to define that because employee is also a person, right? It's a human also. So we can extend, okay? We can extend all we call inheritance in the object-oriented approach. So only a specific thing in the class employee, we can add more. For example, position, salary, okay? And another property and another method inside the class person, we can inherit or we can use we can extend it, okay, and use it again from the class person. This is the advantage of the class of the inheritance, okay, approach. Polymorphism, okay. Polymorphism is mean the ability to have many form, okay. Ability to have many form. Which class have varying functionality while sharing the common interfaces, okay. If we represent one, but it, in class, you can represent one, but in terms of object, we can use for many, okay? For example, here, we have a class person, right? One person can be speak for many languages. Okay, for example, we have English, French, we have German. Okay, so from the class person, as I say here, class polymorphism person. Okay, so you can extend it. Okay, extend to use that polymorphism person to speak, to say in different language, but using the same function that we call function grade, and that defined as abstract function. Okay. Same thing, we using the class person. Okay, right? So we want to say hi, but in terms of different languages. Okay, we don't start to code at the beginning of English, something like this. We don't need to start from person, have name, property, or whatever, so on. But we can extend and say different different languages. We return different languages, but using the same classes. Okay, the same. We extend the same classes, and then we use the same method. You see this one? We have a method named grid. Okay, grid. Okay. So the method grid means we can be implement for the class that extend to it. Okay. For example, class English, we extend grid also. In the class German, we extend grid also. In class French, we extend grid also. If you look at here, there are something misspelling here. It should be a grid, not grid. Okay. Yeah. It should be same function. Okay, same function, following the main super class. Okay, or the parent class. Class diagram will look like as I illustrated on the third figure and the fourth figure. Okay, encapsulation and information hiding. The main point of object is they represent the object, but they do not represent the information inside, that we call wrapping up the data and method into a single unit. This is we call class. The protection mechanism for data and member and method present inside the class. This is we call encapsulation or information hiding. Okay, when we want to express our class, we just express the name of class method, right? But we can specify which method and which class, which property that we want to hidden. Okay, we hidden information inside the class, just show the thing that we can do. Okay, for example, class person can do about person name, and then replace some kind of name, but the name, how they define the name, how can they define the age, or the method that used to represent the method is hidden inside. Okay, if you want to use, you just call and use it. You cannot be access and modify it within the class. Okay, or another meaning is hiding the real implementation of data from the user, and also does not allow anyone to manipulate data member except by calling the desired operation. Okay, when you declare any kind of class, so you encapsulation or information hiding will protecting that information, and then not allow people from outside to modify or make change to our property or method. If you want to need, you just call and use it, or we call the calling the desired operation. Okay, you look back to if you look to any of class that we define, they are implementing the encapsulation and information hiding. Okay, when we show to another person, we show just only they have to extend, they have to define the object. Okay, when they need to use, they just request to use it, and then they cannot be modified the class. Okay, object relationship and association. To make a relation between one class to another, we have to create such we call object relationship and association that can talk to one to another. We have four types. Okay, the general one, we have general we have four types of relationship. Okay, the first is association, aggregation, composition, and the last one is generalization. The symbol that used to represent the relationship of the class between classes, we use this one. Okay, we have association, just only one line. Inheritance, that used to inherit the property and method from the parent or superclass, we use this symbol, the second symbol. And realization, we use another symbol, a dependency, aggregation, and composition. Okay. If you are working with class diagram, okay, you are working with object-oriented okay approach, this thing that you have to be familiar. Okay. Example as this one, this is the class diagram of all the system. It look like this. Okay. There are, you look at class customer, we have a class, right? Class name as customer. We have attribute a name and address. Okay. Name SI as string. Okay. And then we have association between customer and order, okay, that represent in multiplicity, okay, multiplicity that order one and then in customer one and order zero to many, right? So customer can make many order, okay, for each order is depend just only to one customer, okay. And this is represent the whole example of the class, okay, association, okay, class association and relationship, okay. When you drawing some kind of class diagram, it will look like this. And then when you can generate the class diagram from the code, the existing code, you can see something like this. Okay. Interface. Okay. The interface is provide a way for defining a contract to which class adhere. Okay. The interface provide method prototype and constant. Remember this one, they provide the method prototype. Okay. So and any class that implement interface must provide implementation for all method in the interface. Okay, interface can be assigned by interface. Okay, and then if you want to use the interface, we use implement. Okay, the main point of interface is we use this interface to define something that we want to use, and then when someone want to use it, they have to use the same name, okay, the same name that defined in the interface. Okay, for example, you define as a database. Okay, so database name, capital letter, small letter, or whatever. When you implement the interface, you should use the function name of the property and the same thing in the implement class. Okay, you can create interface like this, okay, start by interface and then follow by interface name and then follow by function and function name inside the interface. Okay, for example here we have interface printable, okay, function printable, we have interface printable, function print output. Okay, when we want to use that interface, we use implement printable. Okay, we define one class and then we implement the printable. Okay, you see the function, okay, the function inside the image component, right, they are using the same name. This is the thing that they are discussing about interface. Okay, inside interface there is no statement. Okay, the function inside the interface there is no statement, they just define only the function name and argument. Okay, there is no statement, there is no print echo or something or whatever. They just define the name and then the regulation or role that for the interface. Okay, you can see here. Okay, from printable we can extend to we can implement the printable in class image component, and then the function print output is the same name, same function that we implement from the interface printable. The function is print out. Okay. Imagine that if you want to design your database connection, right? You should define as interface. Okay, you should define as interface because when many person working together to coding, right? We should have something standard that to call a database. Okay, database name, database host, database password, and so on. It should be the same name. Okay. Not everyone use their own standard. It should be one standard for the global things, okay, such as database connection. Okay, abstract classes. Okay, the PHP provides something that we call a mechanism for declaring that certain method on the class must be implemented by superclass. Okay, the implementation of those methods is not defined in the parent class. In this case, you provide an abstract method. In additional, If a class contains any method defined as abstract, you must also declare a class as abstract class. Okay, abstract class means that you can define a class without name of class. Okay, this is the main point of the abstract class. Okay, you can declare the class whatever in code. Okay, you don't need to start by class and follow by class name and then function, but you can declare the class during, inside, or anywhere of the class. This is the main point of abstract classes. You can see here we have the abstract classes component, okay, abstract function, and then we want to abstract class, okay. The abstract can be similar to interface, okay, but a little bit different, okay, a little bit different. You look at here, they are sharing the same thing, but the difference is about they define as abstract. Okay, abstract can be sharing after. Okay, abstract can be sharing after, but the interface, it should be, if you change the inside the interface, it will be not working. Okay, it is not working. Okay, as you can see here, anonymous classes. Okay, anonymous classes. Why creating a mock option object for testing is useful to create anonymous classes. You wanna not test any kind of object, okay? Since you do not serious about, you do not curious to create a new object, so you can use anonymous object. Anonymous class behave the same as any other classes, except they use except that you do not provide a name, which means it cannot be directly instantiated. Okay, you no need to define any name of the anonymous class, but it also cannot be you cannot be instantiated. Mean when you create any class, anonymous class, you cannot initiate as object from that class. Okay, mean that anonymous classes. For example, here we have a class person, right? It's normal classes, and then we have anonymous class as we define as anonymous equal to new classes. This is the anonymous class, okay? And then we extend person, this we call anonymous class. So we do not define any class name, okay? We do not define any class name. Actually, a normal class, we have to define class name, such as we define as class call it extend person, for example. But this one, anonymous, we define any variable and then we create a new class, mean extend from the person. So it work as the anonymous class. Okay, anonymous class can be useful when you want to test something that is working well or not. This one is will be nice. Okay, will be nice. It's for long using, it's not suitable. Okay, because it's difficult to what we call to direct or to notify which class they are using right now. Okay, because there is no name for that class. Namespace, there are two points of namespace. There is to avoid the name, such like this, okay? You see, there are long name, right? Some define long name. So we wanna make it short. This is the main point of namespace. We don't want to remember the name of component, the name of class that define in whatever person written the code, okay? We don't want to remember it, okay? So we have to use namespace. Or the second arm of the namespace is to provide easy way to isolate classes and function from various library. For example, is two person working a different project, but they are setting the same class. So it will be trouble if we have no using namespace. Better to use namespace so it can be used the same name in with different library. Okay, this is the objective of namespace. Okay. You can see here we declaring namespace and call a namespace, for example, namespace shipping, right? And then we declare a courier. Okay, in the courier we have a public name, home country, and then we have the get courier by country, for example. And then we specify namespace freight. Okay, and then we instantiate the object from the class courier by using courier equal to new shipping and then courier. This one. Okay, this is the way how we declare namespace and call. Okay, because you see the first figure, we have a namespace name shipping, right? And then the class name is courier. So in when we need to call that courier, so we use courier equal to new shipping and then courier, right? It's in hierarchy. Okay, in hierarchy, So it follow from the top to below. This is the name that you want to access the namespace by defining that namespace. Okay. You see this one, and the left hand side is the structure of the existing class, okay, or function. We have a chop, right? We have product, we have shipping, right? Inside a product, we have products, we have product categories, we have shipping, we have carriers, right? And admin, we have a user and user. Maybe a capital letter, small letter. This is become the thing that may confuse. So better to use using the namespace, right? For example, we use chop and shipping, right? We can jump to chop and shipping, and then when we want to use, we call the carrier shipping carrier, and then followed by the method that we just declare. Okay, the method that we just declare. Or for example, you see we use a user use as admin slash user as you, right? We can specify as you. So when we want to use, you will use specify as user equal to new and then you slash and then user, right? This one it become easy for you to make it the name for the long sentence, long method or class to be a short, and then we can use within our coding, our code, right? This is the main point of the namespace. Okay, namespace. Before we can run this code, you have to include some kind of the class that related to this code. Okay, for example, class name shipping, right? Class name this one, for example, class name career, right? So you have to include this code before we can run this. Okay. The problem of the old traditional code is we have to load any kind of file that you want to work with, that you use include and require a lot, right, to load the code, right? For example, you require database connection, you require the library.php and so on. This is make you more trouble. Okay, if you have 100 file to include, what will happen to you? It will be long sentence, right? So better to use a method, a function that given by the object-oriented approach that we call autoload. Okay. The autoload is when we tell PHP where to look for our class files. Okay, when it need a class declaration that it yet to see. Okay, we want to we just only one write one line of code and then it can load all classes that are available. Okay. We can use SPL autoload register. This is the function from the PHP that used to run the autoload. Okay. This is we can use example as I say the SPL autoload register function class. So whatever the name of file that include as class, okay, dot something, okay, and then the follow inside it can be class main person.php. Class colleague.php, class register.php. It will load all, okay, at the one single line of code. Okay, this is the advantages of autoload. Any library and framework implement this thing already. Okay, that's why when you declare, you don't need to include or require any code, but it will be autoload already by the library or framework. Okay, this is about object-oriented programming that I would like to present to you. Okay.